dogs, my pillar could not find place for sleep.
Armchair revolutionary. Mm-hmm. If you think something's not right, the next question is, what do you do? The second principle in jihad, brother, is you speak against it. So first you think deeply on it. And the murder of Oscar Grant was replayed on television every day. If you're a human being, black, brown, red, yellow, or white, there's no way you could look at our brother being treated like less than a dog and it not move your heart. So now we're looking at it. We're thinking deeply on it. But then what's the good of thinking deeply on it if you're too cowardly to stand up and say something about it?
That's right.
So we stood up and said something about it. Then the third step of jihad is to do something about it. Mm-hmm. Well, our do something, our do now, school teachers will call it, your do now is organize. Mm-hmm. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said to us that organization is more important than truth. He said, because an organized lie has more power than disorganized truth. So when we began hosting town hall meetings, it was really a sight to see, Brother James. We toured Northern California organizing communities around police brutality and issues, not only Oscar's case, but other cases, because every city found cases like Oscar's without the cameras. And because of modern technology, not only would you find that Oscar's case was on camera, but there were other cases on camera. But none of these cases made it into a courtroom the way Oscar's did. So as you know, Mike Brown out in Missouri, many others, there's video footage now almost everywhere you go. And because of the advent of the cell phone, there are literally hundreds of cases where law enforcement officers have been captured on somebody's camera doing the wrong thing. So we decided that we wouldn't just be armchair revolutionaries, but that we would drive the call of justice. As the program says, we want justice, equal justice under the law. We want justice applied equally to all, regardless to creed or class or color. And if we took it even another step, point number six is we want an immediate end to police brutality and mob attacks against the so-called Negro throughout the United States. Well, if this is the program of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and we are his followers, then what's that old saying, your wish is our command? Okay, well, that means it's something that we have to do. That's that third step of jihad. So it's not sufficient that we sit in our churches and in our mosques and talk about the society. We must act in the society wherein we live to secure justice. Now, if they won't give us justice where we are, then there's another part of that program. Can then give us a separate state or territory that we can call our own, and perhaps then we can live in peace. But while we're under the same roof, while we're in the same land, while we're in the same space, then we cannot coexist while police officers are shooting our children down, slapping our women and killing our men. We cannot coexist in peace, because in Islam, you know, we don't sing "We Shall Overcome" if somebody slaps us in the face. We're not giving them the other cheek. Our cheeks are raw now from 400 years of turning them. That day is done. And I remember the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, I think from Atlanta, in a message he delivered there, raised the question, what are you trying to compel us or make us to do? We'll do all that we can to secure peace in a system if the system will do right. So our role has been to compel the system to do right, but also to warn the system that if you do not do right, our God would do right. And even if he has to do right by our hand, right will be what comes out in the end.
For those who are just now tuning in to the Self-Improvement Basis for Community Development Talk Show, I'm Brother James Muhammad, and I have as my special guest from Oakland, California, through the Minister Abdul Sabir Muhammad, who is the local representative of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. He was on the front line fighting the Oscar Grant case for justice. Many have seen the movie Fruitvale, but we up and close and personal with a man who was on the front line, who have been giving his life for the cause of justice for over 30 years there in Oakland, California, brother. Now, Brother Minister, you've given us a lot of information. I was reading an article on the NPR News that California District Attorney says probe of Oscar Grant killing will be reopened. Now, I know there are some updates to this case. You all have not stopped fighting. And you know what's interesting, Brother Minister? We have these killings and we watch our brothers and sisters and our children down the street. Then there's the protests. Then there's the emotional overload. Then after a while, you hear nothing else. Then we forget. Why is it so important to keep Oscar Grant case and many other cases at the forefront of our minds?
Well, the blessing is, in the case of Oscar Grant, we could see the benefit of community unity.
Oh, yes.
And the power of the people united is what brought that case to trial. But also the focused, organized effort is what brought that case to trial. And I should make sure that you know, when the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan saw it, he told us to tell that mother that she and her son will be the winner. Mm. Well, we don't let it go until justice is served. It's something that you never forget when you've been given an injustice. Mm-hmm. I think the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said that the heavens and the earth cry out for those that have not received justice. Mm-hmm. Well, to every believer, if the heavens and the earth are crying, then so too are our hearts, crying for those who suffer. And you find that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan remains as the voice of those that suffer. I remember being in Compton College while he was delivering a message, and there were mothers there whose children had been slain by gang violence. And while the minister was teaching, one mother cried out in the audience, and he stopped his speech and addressed all of those mothers. He came off the stage with the whole security team and, you know, and backed them off. And he got in a circle of mothers in a crowd of a couple of thousand people and comforted them. The minister feels the hurt of our people sincerely. And we who follow him feel like he feels.
Right.
But our job is to go beyond the feeling toward the action that will alleviate the pain toward bringing justice. And so in this new era, the George Floyd case, brother, brought back very swiftly to our hearts what happened to Oscar, because while we were looking, like with Oscar's case, of the footage of this cop that killed George Floyd by choking him out by putting his knee on his neck, Oscar suffered the exact same maneuver. That's actually a military maneuver. And the cop that did it to Oscar was a military police officer in the Marines. That's something they would do in Palestine, the Israelis, with their knee on the neck of the Palestinians. So it was a technique that Mr. Peroni knew the pain that he was causing Oscar. And by the way, Oscar was never charged with a crime. So why then is he on his face in a felony prone position with a knee on his neck, choking him out, crushing the bones of his face? See, Peroni was never charged. The shooter was charged. But Peroni rained havoc. And because of our activist work, BART hired a private firm to do its internal affairs investigation. And that internal affairs investigation pointed out that that cop, Peroni, caused all that we saw that night. Yet, the district attorney that brought charges against Mesley and retired, they let Peroni go. But when we saw the knee on the neck of George Floyd, Again, my brother in San Francisco, Brother Rashidullah, called and said, are you looking at this? Doesn't that remind you of what happened to Oscar? And I went and searched out the pictures and put a picture of Oscar with Peroni's knee on his neck next to George Floyd with that cop's knee on his neck. And it looked like you're looking at the same picture except in a different year. So we knew at that point, we need to call the DA. Before we did that, we called in organizers so we could begin, as we did in 09, to bring the weight of our unity to the district attorney's office in October, while we were having a press conference to demand that the DA reopen the case, to reinvestigate the case. Before we could finish the press conference, she sent out a press statement, I'm reopening the case. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, if it was something she wanted to do, she had 12 years to do it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't something that she wanted to do. She responded because she saw the pressure coming. And we stood there with Oscar's mom and family making this demand of the district attorney. We've now met with her several times, and she made an effort to drop the case again by saying to us that Peroni was a bad cop, he was a bad actor, but, you know, here comes the but. And she said something to the effect of the injuries to Oscar, according to the coroner's report, don't suggest that Peroni harmed him or it was superficial wounds. But first, Brother James, the coroner's report that they gave us was missing half the pages. Mm-hmm. We've actually brought in the doctor who discovered the CTE injuries of the football players, Dr. Amalo, who's now a legend because now the NFL Players Association has won a $500 million or $1 billion lawsuit against the NFL for their lying about the injuries sustained by the players. A player just the other day was found dead in a hotel at 38 years of age, a wide receiver. Well, that injury was discovered by Dr. Amalo by his study of the brain tissue. Well, we're now working. We're pursuing it very vigorously. That Dr. Amalo will have all the information he needs to make the case that this was not a superficial injury. And by the way, my whole position has been, you don't even need the brain tissue. Look at the videotape. Mm-hmm. And the witnesses who said that Peroni kicked Oscar in the head and his head bounced off the concrete wall that he was sitting in front of. Oscar was on his knees. Mm-hmm. Peroni began to lie in the police reports. He alleged that Oscar tried to bite him, which was a lie. He said that Oscar tried to punch him in the groin, which was a lie. How do we know? It's all on videotape. And 30 seconds or less before Oscar was shot, Peroni jumped in Oscar's face, and I'll say it here, pardon my language, but I'm quoting now the transcript. He said, bitch ass nigga, right? Bitch ass nigga, right? 10 seconds later, Oscar's on his face. 30 seconds later, Oscar's dead. Mm. And unfortunately, in American law, you almost will never find that when our people die under the boot of oppression, if they call us a nigger or hang us from a tree, they don't charge anyone with a hate crime. And they didn't in that case. We had incidents, other ones in Oakland. We had a gunman outside the mosque pointed his gun at the FOI and said, I'll kill you niggers. Well, that was his mistake. The brother Show didn't run away from it. He ran away with his gun. But when the police finally found fit to go and arrest them, we had to encourage them. They didn't want to just go arrest their brother. But we encouraged them. And they went and made the arrest. But while we're talking with the district attorney's offices about what are you charging this man with? Now, he was charged and convicted for threatening the brothers, but he was not charged with a hate crime. Mm-hmm. I ask, well, then what is a hate crime? You got to catch the man at a Klan meeting before it can be charged a hate crime. And quite frankly, if you start looking into the past of these characters that we're talking about, they might find Klan meetings in their past. That happened with Mark Furman in the O.J. Simpson case. He said, I never used the N-word. Peroni did the same thing Mark Furman did in court, brother. Mm-hmm. And that's who we're seeking charges against. in court, Peroni was questioned, did you call Oscar Grant a nigger? He said, oh no, I would never do such a thing. My mother taught me well, and I'm well-trained in the OPD, and you know, we're taught racial sensitivity. And he said, I'm sorry, Mr. Peroni, the DA talking, the prosecutor, did you say that you've never used the N-word and you didn't use it that night on the platform? Oh no, I would never do such a thing. And what Peroni didn't know was that there was video footage with audio. And the prosecutor rolled it back in slow motion. Listen, tell me what you hear. Click, bitch, ass. And they went through that. He tried to resist it for a moment, but went, okay, let's read your lips since you don't think that's your voice. And they slowed it down. And the strange thing, Brother James, was that the media, which was in the courtroom every day, there was a press conference every day of that trial. Not a single reporter had enough courage or audacity to ask the question about Oscar being called that word. None. It took them about 3 weeks or four before another reporter leaked it out. It was as though they were afraid of the public reaction, which was already at a fever pitch, and they did not want for the public to know what this cop said. A Black reporter who I know well came to me and said the next morning, he said, Minister, why don't you have a press conference and say what he said so everybody will know? I looked at the brother, said, brother, don't you work for the network? You're a reporter. Why do I need to have a press conference to state what you were sitting in the courtroom to hear for yourself? No, I'm not going to have a press conference to say that. You and those in the media should take courage to speak the truth. Well, unfortunately, he did not. And it took about a month before that information actually reached the public. But when the final trial made it to Los Angeles, for some reason, they didn't seem it to be relevant to put it into the court record. So, you know, brother, we're fighting this fight and we'll continue to fight this fight. Our charge is that the district attorney charged Anthony Peroni with felony murder. Our charge has been supported by what we call now a dream team of lawyers that include Attorney Crump out there in the South, Attorney Burris in Oakland, Attorney Riley, who's an Oakland activist attorney, and Attorney Bonner, who's a San Francisco activist attorney. All of these men work akin in the way of a Johnny Cochran. You know, they're those types. And we also received support from Judge Hatchett, the television judge. And she jumped in and said, I am an attorney, you know, and told us right away when we talked with her, you all have a case. And the case that's there that they did not charge the first time is called felony murder. Felony murder doesn't mean you did the killing. Felony murder means you participated in the crime that led to the killing. So it's like the driver in a bank robbery where another man in the bank robbing gang shot somebody and you driving the getaway car. The man that did the shooting also got shot and you're driving a getaway car. Okay, well then when they catch up to you, they're gonna charge you who didn't fire a shot with murder. That charge is called felony murder. Mr. Peroni committed felony murder. We counted 6 or 7 felonies against Oscar and his friends by that cop before Mezzali shot him. And if you read these lying cops' reports, you've been amazed, Brother James. Mezzali shot him with a gun. None of the cops would testify that they heard a gunshot. They were testifying, I heard a pop. I heard a loud sound. I thought his taser malfunctioned. They were lying to support Mezzali's position. In fact, Peroni said in a report, he's with Mezzali the whole time. They're like 3 inches away from each other. That in the moment that Mezzali pulls out the gun, he turned his head away from him so he didn't see the gun. Let me get this straight, Peroni. You saw him every other moment of this incident, except for when he pulled out the gun? What you're saying doesn't make any sense. In fact, about it, Mezzali and Peroni said that they feared that Oscar had a gun. Well, brother, you work in medical. but there's some military training in that. But I would imagine that if you thought somebody had a gun and you're a police officer, would you pull out a taser to respond to a gun? Meserly said, I thought he had a gun. Stand back. I'm going to tase him? Who do you tase when you think they got a gun and they're going to shoot you? Mm-hmm. So even the reaction that Meserly gave, the excuse they gave didn't make any sense. In fact, about it, they refined his position when they saw the video footage hit the television news. Then his testimony began to change. It went from, I thought he had a gun, which was the initial statement that cops use because they claim to be justified in killing you if they fear for their lives. So I fear for my life. Peroni, by the way, is a Marine MP. He was a bodybuilder. He was a heavy steroid. The man was yoked. Oscar is 160 pounds, dripping wet, 5'8" or something. There really was no physical opposition that Oscar could give them other than the fact they didn't like the fact that Oscar wouldn't tap dance and say, yowza, boss. Maybe if Oscar said, yowza, boss, and started tap dancing, maybe they would have treated him differently. To all of your viewers, you're men and women. You need not tap dance because a police officer said so. They are trained to function under a law. So are we. And we should obey the law. We obey lawful commands. But you can't ask a Muslim to tap dance.
Then dance for me. I'm going to shoot you.
Or you start shooting and then we'll just have to be on. Mm-hmm. Because we're not going to tap dance for you. Well, Oscar didn't tap dance. And for his refusal to tap dance in some ways, that cop became so incensed that he put all that pain. It reminded me of Rodney King. The more they hit him with the stick, they said he wouldn't stay still. And every time they hit him again, claiming he wouldn't stay still. Who stays still while people are pummeling you with a bully club?
Exactly.
Your natural reaction is to move to protect yourself. Oscar was under the same kind of situation, except that it didn't take as long and that the officer pulled out his gun and killed him rather than kept beating on him. We're firmly convinced, as I close, that Peroni, had Meserly not shot Oscar, the damage Peroni was putting on Oscar could have taken his life. Mm-hmm. It did injure him. And were it not for that fateful shot, we really don't know where this was going with Mr. Peroni. From my vantage point, he was the head of a lynch mob.
Mm-hmm. Wow. But brother,
Meserly brought the rope.
I have to thank you for coming on the Self-Improvement Basis for Community Development Talk Show. For those who saw the movie Fruitville, Brother Minister Abdul Sabir Muhammad is up close and personal in the case and still fighting the case for justice for our brother. I had a chance to meet his mother when I was in Oakland, and it was very touching. And it's, you know, Brother Minister, if it wasn't for you all walking side by side with her, pushing for unity in the community. And you know, I know Oakland, I know Fruitville, I have a personal relationship with that area. This case would have been pushed up under the rug, even with the video.
It was on its way.
Mm-hmm.
But thanks be to Allah for the pillar called jihad. Yeah. We were unrelenting under the thought that we can't just cuss out the TV. We had to get up and do something. And again, organizing is what we did. And that's what we're still doing. So we would encourage everyone to pay close attention to the Final Call newspaper. You'll see more as the days proceed, as we're seeking that these charges that should have been brought against Peroni 12 years ago will be brought now.
Brother Minister, you had a book in your hand behind Message to the Black Man. Can you hold that book up, please? Yes, sir. Tell us something quickly about that book in closing.
This book was inspired by Allah on me. After the case concluded, we had put in nearly 2 years of nonstop work, and my mind just had to unleash a record of everything that we did in an organizing effort. has actually been used as a textbook at Merritt College in the Black Studies Department at Laney College. And it's called Grant Justice, Lessons Learned, Fighting for Justice in the Murder of Oscar Grant. And we made it available at that time. I'm told now you can find it on the black market. So it's been bootlegged a bit, but I'm happy to share it with you and your viewers. They just contact you and give me an email contact and I'll send you a copy. And if you like to make a donation, that's fine. If not, there's a lesson in it for organizing efforts all over the country on how to call Black Muslims, Christians, and activists together for the cause of justice.
And you know why that book is so important? Because as I was listening to you, brother, you all during this process have created a blueprint for justice for our people. And the most important part of that blueprint is the unity that you all created that put the force that brought about the justice. And I think people need to stay in touch with you all to learn how to do this now, because the conviction rate is very low when it comes to Black men versus cops. So I'm gonna have you back on the show. I want you to please come back with an update on this case as it moves on, because I know you're not gonna give up. I can see it in your face.
Praise be to Allah. We look forward to it. And I would be even happier if we would bring with me members of our coalition, yes, and the Oscar Grant Foundation with Oscar's mom as we're pursuing the case. I think there's so many legends and activists working with us. We have now part of the coalition, the last chairperson of the Black Panther Party. And I laughed with her just yesterday, saying to her that when I moved to Oakland, I was looking for Black Panthers and I couldn't find it. Mm-hmm. Now I'm on the phone with the Black Panther chairperson every day. And that would be Sister Elaine Brown. Yesterday was the birth anniversary of Huey Newton, for whom a street was actually named yesterday after him in his honor, right there in West Oakland. So we are certainly looking forward to sharing with the world what has happened, because we know what have happened in Oakland can happen anywhere if we're willing to pursue justice in a united way.
And Oakland is a different city. I have to have you all back on so we can talk about the history in Oakland and the revolutionaries in Oakland also. So I'm looking forward to having you and your guests on so we can look deeper into this case, because the movie cannot tell it all. So brother,
that's right.
I thank you for coming on. Brother Minister is one of my mentors, one of my big brothers. Yeah, you're older than me, Brother Minister.
I think you got me by 2 months, Brother James.
So, Brother
Praise Minister, be to Allah.
I love you all out there in Oakland, California. Thank you for coming on the Self-Improvement Basis for a Community Development Talk Show. Until next time, peace be unto you, brother.